This video will explain the Java Persistence API, JPA, which is an object-relational mapping framework, or OR mapping framework. And what that means is exactly what I'm about to explain now. Now there is my program up to the left, this red thing here, and each of these squares is an object in the program. So in the program we have created this graph of objects. There is this object that has references to three other objects and so on. And there are some bidirectional relationships as here. There is kind of cyclic dependence this way. Okay, so it's a complicated object graph. Maybe this is overly complicated. Maybe the graphs are not this complicated normally, but certainly we have big object graphs in our programs. Okay, so now we're about to store this object graph in the database. So just consider the amount of SQL and and JDBC code that we wrote in the bank, JPA bank program, which had just one single object in the model, no graph at all. Imagine storing this complex graph. We would have to store each object separately, dig out the fields of each object, and then create relations, foreign keys, and the relational tables to create all the relations between these objects. And then, if we were to search for a particular object, this one for example, we would have to dig out the fields of each individual object from its corresponding table and then try to create the relations to glue together the entire object graph again from the relational database. So that would really be a nightmare trying to store such a graph in the database. It would require a tremendous amount of SQL and JDBC code. So imagine now if instead we don't have this nightmare, but instead of it we could pass this entire object graph to some framework which would take care of persisting it to the database. So here there would be just plain Java objects. We just pass the entire Java object to this blue thing and ask it to persist the entire graph. And then this blue arrow, which is part of this component, the blue component, would take care of all the JDBC and the SQL code for us, and we would not have to write any of that. So here we would like to be able to give commands like persist and pass the entire object graph, and maybe find, to find an object and get the entire object graph back up again. And this is exactly what JPA does. This blue component is JPA, or another OR mapping framework. So that's the purpose of an OR mapping framework, not having to write the SQL code ourselves, but handle only plain Java objects in our program. Now I will first a bit conceptually explain JPA by drawing a diagram here, and then I will explain it more in detail by showing the bank program using JPA instead of JDBC. These are the main components, the frameworks and APIs involved. So the red thing is my program that I'm writing, and it's going to use a database, the black thing. So as previously, we have the JDBC API, which is responsible for sending SQL statements to the database. The JDBC API will use a driver provided by the database vendor. That's why it's black, the same color as the database, and the blue thing is JDBC. But the difference now with JPA is that we are not calling JDBC from our program. Instead, we will call JPA. So the big green box is JPA, which I'm going to fill with JPA concepts. The entry point that JPA provides to our program is called Entity Manager. The Entity Manager provides methods like persist that stores an object in the database, and find that searches in the database, and merge that takes an object that already exists in the database and merges its state to the database. And there are more similar methods for database interaction. So our program will call those methods. But it is not the entity manager itself that calls the database. Instead, there is an object of another class that holds the JDBC connection, and that is the entity manager factory. The entity manager factory is an heavyweight object that represents a connection to the database, and it takes time to create an entity manager factory, so we should not create new entity manager factory objects. Instead, we should reuse such objects. The entity manager, on the other hand, is a lightweight object, just a plain Java object that uses the connection of the entity manager factory to call the database. So entity managers can be created at will. So as the name reveals, it is the entity manager factory that creates entity managers. That is done by the method createEntityManager. So from our program, we shall call the createEntityManager method of entityManagerFactory when we want an entity manager. But how do we start JPA? How do we get the entity manager factory to connect to the database? For that, we need yet another class. So I've redrawn the image and made the JPA part larger so all classes can fit in there. So now I've also added this new class, which is called persistence, and whose task is to create the entity manager factory, and that is done by the method create entity manager factory, this one, which our program also must call. That's how to start JPA. So the very first thing to do when starting JPA is then to call the static method create entity manager factory of the class persistence, which will start JPA and also make the entity manager factory connect to the database via JDBC. And the second thing is to call create entity manager on the newly created entity manager factory object. But how will JPA, and in particular the entity manager factory, know to which database to connect? We tell it by creating an XML file which defines a persistence unit. This file is red because it's created by us, but I wrote persistence unit in green because it defines something that is used by JPA, namely the persistence unit. So the persistence unit tells which database to use, and it also tells objects of which classes can be stored in the database by JPA. So these classes that can be stored in the database are not really called classes, but are called entities. An entity is a class that can be stored in the database and also its representation in the database, for example a table. So an entity is two things, both the class and the table in the database. Remember, this is about OR mapping. So JPA maintains both an object-oriented in our program and the relational in the database representation of all its entities, all the things that can be handled. And those things are classes in the object-oriented representation and tables in the database. And JPA handles the translation between these. But as far as JPA is concerned, an entity, for example, account in the bank, is the same both in the database and in the program. And objects of this class are called entity instances. An entity instance is both an object of the entity class and a row in the table where the entity is stored persistently in the database. Okay, so I promised in the JDBC video to introduce transactions when talking about JPA. So now I added a class, this class here, entity transaction, which is responsible for handling a transaction. So a transaction is a grouping of a set of operations, of database calls, persist, find, merge, delete, and so on. And in a transaction, either all of the operations are performed or none of the operations are performed. So the entity transaction has methods like begin, which starts a new transaction, commit, which performs all the operations in the transaction. The updates made during the transaction are actually stored persistently in the database. And rollback, which undoes whatever was performed during the transaction, and all those operations are discarded, and it is as if they were never performed. Okay, so what remains then is to define the classes in our program of which objects can be stored in the database. Those are the entity classes. which are defined in the persistence unit XML file. So those are classes in our program, and they are almost plain Java classes, except for some very small details. So it can be, for example, the account, the bank account. One of the very small details that make them differ from just any plain Java class is that they must be annotated entity. So this line, as we soon will see in the example program, the at sign and something afterwards, is a perfectly legal Java statement, and it's called an annotation. And it's a line of Java code that is never executed, but instead provides information to something, for example to the compiler or to the JVM or to some framework, as is the case here when it provides information to JPA. So JPA can read this annotation and see that this class is an entity class that can be persisted to the database. And an entity class must also have an ID annotation, which defines a primary key, that is some field in the class that is unique for every object in the class. So that field annotated ID is the primary key of this entity instance, which uniquely identifies an instance from other instances of the same entity. And it is also used as the primary key of the table in the database. So that we can have any number of such entities in our program, and they can have ordinary Java references to each other that will also be persisted in the database, as we soon will see in the example. The JPA term for these references is association. An association is a Java reference between two entities. It's a plain Java reference, but it must have some annotation to tell JPA that this reference should be stored in the database. So these are the JPA abstractions that will be used by our program. We will see a few more annotations when we look at the example program, the JPA bank, but these are the main concepts. There is one more thing before we turn to the program, and that is that internally JPA maintains something called the context. So the context is like a hash table, you could say. I don't know if it actually is a hash table, but it's a very good model to think of it like a hash table, which is a set of key value pairs. Each key consists of an entity name and a primary key. And the value is the entity instance or object of that entity that has this primary key. So the context is like a cache where the entity manager can look for a certain instance of an entity. So the entity part of the key defines which class this entry in the context is for, and the primary key defines which entity instance. And the value is the actual entity instance. The context defines which instances the entity manager is aware of. If an instance is present in the context, its state is tracked by the entity manager. The entity manager will know all updates that are made to that instance, and at the end of the current transaction, those changes, that is, changes to the fields in that instance, will be stored in the database. But if an instance is, on the other hand, not in the context, then the entity manager has no clue what is going on with that instance, and updates to that instance will be lost. They are only made in the program and will never be synchronized to the database. So this will be explained in further detail when we look at the program. An object can enter the context by us in the program somehow informing the entity manager of its existence. For example, by telling the entity manager to persist it, or by telling the entity manager to search for it in the database. It is also important to understand that the context is discarded at the end of every transaction. When a new transaction starts, the entity manager will not know about any instance at all, but will have to be informed about all instances that it shall track during that transaction. Okay, so to finalize the numbering here, so first, when starting JPA, we have to do number one here, called create entity manager factory on the persistence class to connect to the database and create the connection, the JDBC connection held by the entity manager factory. Before that, of course, let's call it zero. we must have written the XML file that defines the persistence unit, for example, the database to which persistence shall create the connection used by the entity manager factory. Okay, then we have the entity manager factory connected to the database. Then we can use the entity manager factory to create the entity manager by calling create entity manager. Then we call the getTransaction method of that entity manager to get a transaction object. Then we start a new transaction. So number four, we start a transaction by calling begin on that transaction object. And then five, we use the methods of the entity manager, persist, find, merge, whatever, to do what is actually required. And then six, we either commit or rollback. Those are the steps performed. Okay, so that's JPA in theory. Soon we'll turn to practice. First, I would just like to comment that maybe you think this looks extremely complex. Why do all these things? And we don't even know what's going on under the hood in JPA. Why not just write JDBC? Yeah, that's a legal objection. That is perfectly valid. And it's somehow up to the programmer. I would say that JPA is complicated to use. It's really not a good objection. The other one is better. We don't know what's going on inside JPA. Maybe it's slow. That's a more valid objection. Because considering the first objection, JPA is complicated. Sure, there are things to learn and you will get strange errors. The exceptions and error messages are not really that informative. So you will run into problems using it. But on the other hand, the best thing to understand how complex it is not to use it is to try to write program using just plain JDBC. I mean, maybe you can imagine if you have just, say, a few tenths of entities, that is, classes of which objects shall be stored in the database, and they have references to each other, and you have like 10 or something tables in the database that have relations to each other, and you have relational tables, and yeah, you must handle all the fields in all these objects. Say that you end up with like 50 fields or something, I don't know, that must be extracted from the objects and stored in the database when storing, and extracted from the database and inserted into the objects when reading from the database. And then you have to manage all the relations in correct way. And you also have to make sure that your object model and your database is always kept consistent, represent exactly the same state of each object. So you end up with a lot of SQL code and JDBC code, and I would not call that easier than using JPA. The other objection, JPA might be slow because we don't know what's going on. Yes, I think that's a very good objection. If you use JPA for a program of some size, your code will be really simplified, but you run the risk of having a very slow program. To use JPA in a good way, you should have an understanding of not exactly what goes on inside JPA, but at least of how to configure JPA to make it run fast. To use JPA or any other OR mapping framework, you have to understand it and you have to be able to configure it in a good way. But then again, that in a sense goes for the database itself as well. Even if you just use plain JDBC and SQL, you still have to understand how to configure the database, or you can lose a lot of performance in the database. One last thing before we turn to the code. The only class in the JPA specification of the green things here is persistence. All the others are just interfaces. So that means that just like JDBC is a specification for which you need an implementing driver, JPA is just a specification with a set of interfaces. You need a JPA implementation to use it. We have to specify a JPA implementation that implements all these interfaces and provides the functionality. And that is done in the persistence unit XML file. Okay, that's the complete JPA picture, or at least as complete as it will get in this course. Now let's turn to the example. The JPA bank, which does exactly what the JDBC bank does. So therefore I'm not going to run it, but instead just look at the code. So the JPA bank is located in these packages, and the fact is that all packages are practically identical except for the model and integration on the server side, because that's where JPA is used. Ideally, both controller and model should have been identical between the JDBC and JPA bank, because the idea is that all database-specific things which include JPA and JDBC should be located in the integration layer. For the controller, we are almost there. It is practically identical between the JDBC and JPA versions. The difference is mainly due to the fact that in the JDBC version we skipped transactions, which was not a very good idea, but just an oversimplification to make the program easier to understand. For the model, the thing is that it's the JPA entities that make up the model in the JPA bank, and those contain a lot of JPA annotations. We could have kept the model from the JDBC version, just plain Java objects, but then we would have had to use the JPA entities just to move data from the integration layer to the model layer. But there's really no point in doing that. We can the JPA model to be the same as the JDBC model, only that we added the JPA annotations. So the integration layer is completely different, because that's where the database specific things are located. So then let's work through the steps of this image in order. And we start with number 0, have a look at the definition in this XML file, the persistence unit file. So it is located in other sources here. First we need a JPA implementation, and that's this one. In this example we're using Eclipse Link, which has this main class. Okay, so that was the implementation. Next, define the entities in the program. That's these two lines. There are two entities in this program, the account and the holder. In the JDBC bank, there was just one class, account, and the holder was a field in that class. It could have been created exactly that way also here. But there are two classes in order to show how relations work. We need two classes to have a relation between them. Then there's a definition of the database. That's these lines here. First, the URL here is the JDBC URL of the database we are using. So the bank here, the database here is called JPA Bank. Then here is the username. Here is the password. And here's the JDBC driver. Remember that JPA needs the JDBC driver to contact the database. And these lines that are commented out provide URL and driver for MySQL, in case you would like to use MySQL instead. So that means we have also defined the database in the persistence unit, and thus the persistence unit is complete. There are a few more lines, namely these two lines. Drop and create tells what JDBC should do with the tables in the database. The database itself must exist. There must be a database JPA bank, but the JPA can create the tables in that bank. Now that we have the value drop and create, JPA will delete existing tables and recreate new empty tables. There is also the nothing option, which means that tables must already exist and JPA does nothing to them. And there is the create option, which means that they are created if they do not exist, but are kept if they exist. And then there is the logging level configuration here, and setting it to fine makes JPA print all SQL statements that are sent to the database, and that's good to understand what actually happens. It's also good for debugging purposes. Okay, so that's persistence XML. Now, if you use JPA, then you would like to create your own persistence unit. And it's easiest not to start by an empty file and writing it by scratch, but instead use the NetBeans wizard, or whatever wizard there is in your IDE. In NetBeans, you choose, I right-click the project, choose New, Other, Persistence Unit name, whatever I want to call it. Yeah, and here I can define all the different properties. And if I do not have a database connection here, I choose new database connection and get the wizard to create also the database. Also, one more thing before we leave the persistence unit, it has a name, because JPA must know which XML file to read. The name of this persistence unit is bank persistence unit. Now that we move to number one, which is to call the persistence class to create the entity manager factory, we must refer to that same name. And this is the line where JPA is started. So we call the create entity manager factory method in the persistence class and specify the persistence unit. Now we're done with step 0 and step 1 in this diagram. And it's time for step 2. But remember, step 0 and step 1 were the only ones that were taken once per application. The others are taken numerous times. For each new operation, we create a new entity manager, which is the next step 2, and do all interactions with it, which are the remaining steps. So now we are at operation specific steps, and therefore I will explain a specific operation. And I've chosen the find account by name operation, which searches for an account whose holder has a specific name. And there is also a boolean in this method, which specifies if the transaction should be committed or left running when this method returns. And that is because if we only want to find the account and then we're done, just see the balance for example, then of course the transaction should commit, we are done. But maybe we are searching, maybe we want to find the account in order to do a deposit, update the balance of the account, and then store the new balance to the database. Then we must keep the transaction running until the balance has been updated in the database, because otherwise it might be that I will explain this because it's important to try and explain. It's typical race condition. Say we have two threads, T1 and T2, and they represent different clients. So both call this method find account by name, and they both find the same account, say the account for holder Stina. Say the balance at this point is 2, then the thread T1 deposits 5, the thread T2 deposits 8. So the balance in thread T1 is now 7, and the balance in T2 is now 10. Then T1 writes, and the balance in the database becomes 7. Then T2 writes, and the balance in the database becomes 10. But in the reality, the balance in the database should have been 15, because it should have been the original 2 plus the deposit of thread 1, which was 5, plus the deposit of thread 2, which was 8, and this makes 15. So the balance in the database is now wrong, and the reason for that is that they were allowed to work on the account concurrently. Instead, we should have had a transaction running all the way from here until here. So that means that if T1 went first, it would deposit its 5 and the new database balance would be 7. Then only would T2 be allowed to start, and it would read the new balance 7. Deposit 8, and then its balance would be the correct 15, which would be the new state of the database as well. So therefore we must have a long running transaction in this case, and that's why this boolean exists here. If we are searching for the account in order to do a deposit or withdrawal or any update, then we need to keep the transaction running. Okay, so first there's a call to the private method begin transaction. I created a private method for this because this code is similar for all transactions. So the first line is to create the entity manager. So that's step number 2. Call create entity manager on the entity manager factory. Okay, so we're done with that and have the entity manager here. Let's skip this line for now. I will come back to it later. Instead, we go to look at this line. Call get transaction on the entity manager, which is step number 3. The get transaction method, which returns the entity transaction. If there is no transaction already running, if there is a transaction running, no point in starting a new one. Actually, it's illegal to start a new one. But if no transaction is running, we start a new one called begin on the transaction. And that's step number 4. Okay, so those were the steps. 2, 3, and 4 are steps to start a new transaction, and that must be done before any operation is performed. So then it's time for step number 5, which is to perform the actual work. So the work in this case is to search for an account given the account holder's name, and that's done on this line. So now we use the entity manager. The entity manager was returned by the private method we just looked at, and we use that one to create a query. We're going to search in the database, so we need a query. A named query means that we have defined a query with the name, find account by name, and this query is going to return an object of the account class. So where is this query defined? It's defined in the account object in the model. Let's look at that object. So here there are lots of queries. This annotation named queries is used to define queries that we can execute. So here are the queries. This is the find account by name query. So this name must be the same as this name for the query to be created. And here is the actual query, which is written in JPQL, which is an SQL-like language. You could call it object-oriented SQL. It means Java Persistence Query Language, and is a SQL-like language defined in the JPA specification. Okay, so let me explain what this does. It's a select statement, just like an SQL select, which will search in the database. It will search for the object ACCT, which is defined here. So this part that is highlighted now says that the object ACCT is of the entity account, which is this class here. So here is the name. Here is the entity annotation, which was required for an entity, and here is the name of this entity account. So that account refers to this account here. And this ACCT here, which defines an object, which is this ACCT here, and also the ACCT here. So the object ACCT of type account should be found in the database, not all rows, but only rows where this is true. So after where comes the search statement, the criteria. So this object has a property called holder, which has a property called name. And so let's look at that first. So the property holder is here. So it's an entity instance of type holder. Holder is another entity. And it has the property name. So this means that the account's holder's name should have this value. This is a parameter, holder name here, after the colon. It's a parameter, like the question mark with the JDBC prepared statements, back to the DAO. So we create an instance of this query. We set the parameter holder name to holder name. So this was the parameter of the query in the account class, and this holder name here is the parameter of this method. So we will search for account instances, accounts which has where the holder has this name. And then we call getSingleResult, which will execute this query and return the result, the entity instance. So getSingleResult assumes there is only one such instance, one row in the database. We will get an exception if there are many accounts with this holder name. The work is performed. The work was number 5. Which meant one or more calls to the methods in the entity manager to interact with the database. What remains is then number 6, to quit the transaction. And that can be done either by committing or rolling back. So we enter the finally block. Remember that if there is a try block which has a finally block, the code in the finally block will always be executed. There is no way to leave the try block without executing the finally block. It doesn't matter if we do a return or if an exception is thrown or whatever, we will always execute the finally block. So in the finally block, we call the private method commit transaction. Commit transaction, we retrieve the transaction and call commit. So that's point six here, call commit. Okay, but now I have to explain this line and this line, this thread local entity manager thing. So this has really nothing to do with JPI, the thread local entity manager. It's no JPI specific thing, but it's a good way to handle data that is specific per thread, not per object. Normally fields in a class are unique per object, but sometimes we need data that is unique per thread, and then we can use an instance of the thread local Java lang thread local class. So a thread local basically is just a value that is stored in the thread, not in an object. So even though many different threads will use this object, the thread local object, for example the threads T1 and T2, they will have their own value. So what is stored in the thread local object by thread T1 will be stored in the location in memory used only by thread T1, and what is stored by the thread T2 will be stored in a location in memory that is used only by thread T2. So it could be that thread T1 writes X, thread T2 later writes Y, but when thread T1 reads, it will still read its own X. That value was not overwritten by thread T2's Y. Okay, and it is type safe. So this thread local, which is in the variable thread local entity manager, contains an object of type entity manager. So what happens is that previously when we called begin transaction and retrieved the entity manager from the entity manager factory, we stored that entity manager in the thread specific storage, thread local entity manager of the calling thread. Later when we need the entity manager here, we can call get. The thread that calls get here will retrieve its own entity manager, because an entity manager should never be shared between the different threads, because an entity manager is not thread safe. It is to be used just by one thread and one transaction, and the same goes for the transaction object. Okay, so then we're done. We did all the six steps, and by using transactions and the thread local storage, there is no synchronized anywhere. So that means we do not have the problem of serializing all threads through the server. In the bank JDBC program, only one thread at a time could execute in the server. So in spite of the fact that the server was multi-threaded, it still behaved like a single-threaded server, only one thread at a time executing. But here, with the help of transactions, we can have multiple threads executing at the same time. And that's because the transaction engine is smarter than the synchronized keyword. I will not go into transaction handling details, but there is a higher level of concurrency without introducing the risk of race conditions when using a transaction manager. So those were all the steps taken during an interaction with a database using JPA. All steps, except step number 5, are identical. Now I will only look at different ways to use the entity manager, and I will do that by covering the rest of the methods in the bank DAO. But before doing that, we need to understand the lifecycle of an entity instance. The entity instance can be in 4 different states: new, managed, detached, and removed. And first, when it is created, it first enters the new state. So that is by the new keyword. We write, for example, new account and create an object. In the object-oriented model in the program, an entity instance is a Java object. So when we create an object, newly created instance enters the new state. And in the new state, it has no persistent ID, which means it has no value of the primary key that is synchronized between program and database. Also, it is not associated with a context. Remember, a context is the entity manager's store of entity instances. Instances in the context are those managed by the entity manager. So therefore, when I say that it is not associated with a context, it means that it is not under control of any entity manager. Simply speaking, JPA knows nothing about it. We want, of course, to inform JPA about the existence of this instance, and then we call persist on the entity manager. And when the instance has been persisted, that is when we have called persist on the entity manager, it is under control of the entity manager, and the entity manager will know if its state changes. And when it then becomes managed, it is not yet in the database. It will appear in the database only when the transaction in which it is persisted commits. But as soon as we have called persist, it has a persistent ID, a primary key whose value will be maintained, and it is associated with the context. It is inserted into the context, and the entity manager knows about its existence and tracks state changes. And this fact that the entity manager tracks state changes means that if we update the entity and the transaction commit, the new state will be automatically stored in the database. So this is one of the great things of JPA. If you search for an entity instance, update the state of that instance, and then commit the transaction, then the new state will be stored in the database. You don't have to explicitly store the new state. When an instance is read from the database using find or a query, as was the case in our example, it enters the managed state. Okay, so an entity instance can move to the detached state. The detached state means that it has still a persistent ID, but it is no more under control of the entity manager. It could be, for example, that it was serialized and sent over RMI, as is the case in our application. When an account instance has been found on the server, the entity instance will be serialized and returned back to the client. And of course, the JPA entity manager running on the server has no clue what is going on the client. Then the deserialized representation of the object will not be managed by the entity manager. The entity manager has lost control over it. But when we want to update, we want to move it back to the server and update it maybe, then we want to merge it. So an instance can go from detached to managed by calling merge on the entity manager. Say that the client wants to send the account back to the server. I don't know if this would be a good idea. So a serialized object arrives over RMI, and the entity manager is supposed to understand which entity instance it is. Then we must call merge on the entity manager to inform the entity manager that it exists. And since also the detached instance has a persistent ID, it is possible to merge it. Okay, the last state removed is when we want to delete this instance. And an instance moves to the removed state when we call remove on the entity manager. Remove informs the entity manager that this instance should be deleted, both from the context and from the database. And later when the transaction commits, it will actually be deleted from the database. So now that we know the entity instance lifecycle, we can have a look at the rest of the operations in the bank DAO. So first there is the find all accounts method, which finds not only those with a particular holder, but all existing accounts. And we use a query, but this time the find all accounts query, which selects all accounts without any search condition. And here we will not get just one result, but a list. So we call getResultList, which executes the query and returns all the existing accounts. If there was no account at all, we get a no result exception, and then we return an empty list. Then there is the create account method, which persists an account. So this account is created in the controller. Here's the controller, and the account is created here and then passed to create account. So in create account, this newly created account is persisted to the database by calling persist on the entity manager. So before calling persist, it was in the new state, and when persist is has been called, it is in the managed state, and when commit transaction is called, it is created also in the database. Then there is the update account method, which just commits a transaction. So this is supposed to be used after an account has been found by calling, for example, find account by name, this one, and then depositing or withdrawing, and thus changing the state, that is the balance. So then we, this is nice, right? We don't have to extract the new balances in any way or anything like that, because it is in the managed state and is associated with this entity manager's context. So the entity manager keeps track of the new state if we change state of the account, for example, by calling deposit or withdraw. So all that has to be done is to commit the transaction, and the new state will be written to the database. Let's look at this in the controller, for example, deposit. So first call find account by name, and this setting this parameter to false means that the transaction is not committed when find account by name returns. Then we call deposit on this account, which will change the balance of the account. And then we just call update account. And this update account just commits the transaction, and the new balance is written to the database. So then there is delete account, which gets the holder name, the name of the holder of the account that shall be deleted. So then we again create a query, this time the delete account by name query, which is this one, that deletes from the account and entity the instance ACCT, where the holder's name is equal to the parameter holder name. And the parameter holder name is here set to the value of the parameter method parameter. And then we execute this update. So when we execute this update, the entity instance state is changed to removed, this state removed. And when the transaction commits, it is actually removed from the database. So those were all the operations in the DAO. And as I said, the controller is nothing special. It's very similar to the controller of the bank JDBC example. So what remains then is to look at the entities. So let's have a look at the account entity then. So we've already seen that there are a number of named queries defined here. I will not go into locking type. It's a bit beyond the scope of this course. This thing is here to provide efficient locking, because transactions need to handle locks, right, to avoid race conditions. Okay, so it's a plain Java class. I've explained previously in the video about the JDBC bank why it implements account DTU, so it has nothing to do with JPA in particular. JPA would work equally well without that. But it has this annotation entity, which tells JPA that it can be persisted to the database. And there's a name for the entity. So this account is what is referred to in the queries. Okay, then there's the ID annotation that I mentioned previously when talking about JPA concepts, and ID defines the primary key. So placing ID here means that it's this field that is the primary key. This column annotation is actually not needed. It specifies the name of the column in the database. It could be omitted, and then JPA would invent the name of the database column. So this thing here tells how the primary key is to be generated, and generation type auto means that we don't care. We let the JPA decide on its own which strategy to use to generate primary key values. The same thing here, a column annotation to tell the column name of the balance column in the database. Then there's the reference to the other entity, holder. Holder is also an entity class. Join column is exactly like the column, specifies the name of the column that will hold the foreign key of the holder entity instances. But when it comes to a relation to another entity, the annotation is join column instead of column. But then this annotation is the interesting one. One-to-one specifies that this field holder is a one-to-one association to another entity. It means that instances of the account entity can have an association that is a reference to an instance of the holder entity. So one-to-one means that one account is associated with one holder. This is a unidirectional annotation. It means that a count is associated with a holder, but the opposite is not true. The holder is not associated with an account. Why not look at this in the database? So now I have started the program, and let's look in the database then. So you can see that there are two tables, well actually three tables. The account and the holder are the two entities. Account instances are stored in the account table, holder instances are stored in the holder table. And the sequence table is used for primary keys. But let's not dig deeper into that. Let's instead view the account and the holder content. So there's nothing, of course, since the database has just been created when the program started. Nothing in the account and also nothing in the holder table. So here's the holder empty and here's the account empty. So, but now let's insert something. So we create a new account for Olle. Now there is an account, right? And now let's look in the tables. So we load the account. So now there is an account, but the name Olle does not appear here. Instead, for holder, there is the foreign key 2. So let's look at the holders table. And now we see here the ID 2 is Olle. So both were created, both were persisted in the database. This is just one simple example, unidirectional one-to-one. There are many other types as well. But since those are not present here in this program, I will show you some slides quickly to introduce other annotations. So important what is written here, that these associations, the relations between entity instances, are managed by JPA. That was our starting point, right? We wanted to save an entire object graph. In the example, there is just the account, which also has a holder. But when the account is saved to the database, also the holder is saved in the database. And when the account is read from the database, also the holder is read from the database. The relationship can be unidirectional or bidirectional. In the program, it was unidirectional, but can also be both ways. Both instances have a reference to the other instance. We only saw a one-to-one. There can also be one-to-many, many-to-one, or many-to-many associations. So let's look at this example where there is a one-to-many, many-to-one association. So here there is an employee who works at a department. And the employee can only work at one department, but the department has many employees. So this is our database person would write it, right? Employee is the many side and department is the one side. A programmer would write with an asterisk here and a one there. But anyway, employee is the many side and department is the one side. So therefore the department property at the employee side is just a plain Java reference to an object, can hold one department. And also the specification here is many to one. This is the many side to one side. Then at the other end, the department end, we have the one side. So this is the one to many side. And therefore employee here, the employee property, is a collection that can contain many employees. And here we see this mapped by property of the annotation. So it means that the department side is the owning side and has the foreign key in the database. And important here is that department here does not refer to this name department, but instead the department refers to the name of the property at the other end. So employee is the owning side that has the foreign key, and that's how it has to be. For one-to-many and many-to-one relationships, the many side must be the owning side, and that's how you normally do database design, right? For one-to-one and many-to-many relationships, any side may be the owning side. Then let me mention that updates can cascade along relationships. So if something happens to one end of an association, the same thing will happen to the other end. And what shall cascade can be specified. Often we want everything to cascade, then we specify all. And that's also the case in the JPA bank. But we can also specify specific operations that shall cascade, merge, persist, refresh, or remove. So back to the program. So here in the program we see that Cascade has been set to all. The version thing here is for locking, and as I said before, I will not go into the particularities of locking. A JPA entity must have a public no-arg constructor. That's why this thing exists, because that's the constructor JPA will use when it creates such an object. Okay, the rest, good news. No JPA or JDBC or database related code in any way. And this is really good news. Look at the methods updating the state of the account here. Nothing related to database. And the same in the controller. Deposit, just call deposit. And this method, find account by name, we know it performs a search, and we know that this method, update account, just commits. And well, let's look at commit also then. Just calls commit. So there is no handling of fields in the database. I mean columns in the database or fields in the object. We don't have to bother about it. That was the account entity. Let's have a look at the holder entity as well. In fact, there is nothing new here. No annotations or anything that we have not seen yet. Perhaps I should mention that it implements serializable because it is transferred over the network to the RMI client. So that was everything concerning JPA.